This is just one of the greatest of all subjects. The topic today is the gratitude attitude. The gratitude attitude. I'm going to tell you how your life can be turned around by an attitude of gratitude. We have with us today from the Disney family a very beautiful person. She's sung for us before, Melissa Disney. And as somebody said to me, she's going to really do a duet today. And when she comes up, you're going to find out why. So we're so glad to have from the Disney family that is famous around the world, Melissa Disney. A woman, a friend of mine, was dying of an awful sickness. Some of you know of whom I'm speaking. And the time came when she was facing death. She didn't think she'd last through the night. And in the depths of her darkness, she prayed and she said, God, the medication doesn't seem to be working, all the normal procedures. And she started to open herself up to God and say, God, I want you to forgive me for all of my sins. And then she said, I want to pray for the people who've sinned against me, the people that I feel have hurt me. She started to pray a prayer of forgiveness for people who'd hurt her. And then she said, she made up her mind there on her deathbed, but she didn't die, that she would develop an attitude of gratitude, or the gratitude attitude. And she started to thank God for all the good things that were happening to her. Could you imagine? She started to thank God for all the good things that had happened in the past. She told me personally, I interviewed her and talked to her. She told me from that moment onward, she started to get better. I want you to know there is a tremendous positive healing force if you have what we've got written over here on these blackboards. If you have a gratitude attitude. Here in this great country of the United States, we celebrate a beautiful day. It's called Thanksgiving. And it is a day when we try to develop an attitude of gratitude. I want you to take your Bibles and turn to a text that I think is one of the most wonderful texts in the Bible. In fact, it is the high point, some would say, of all of sacred scripture. It is Romans chapter 8 and verse 28 and onwards. And the great Jewish scholar, St. Paul, writes these words under inspiration of God. Romans 8. You folks doing okay here today? Amen. Is everybody happy here today? I want you to do something before we go any farther. Would you hold up your Bible now? I want the world to see the Bibles here and say, this is my Bible. This is God's Word. God is going to bless me here today. I'm going to ask God to open up my heart so I can listen to His voice. And His Word is going to make me a better person. And His Word is going to give me everlasting life. I now open my heart to receive God's Word in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Thank you. Would you please notice Romans chapter 8? Verse 28, Paul says, and we know, good thing to know something and to be absolutely certain of it. And we know that in all things, God works for the good of those who love Him, who have been called according to His purpose. That's one reason we can have the gratitude attitude. For those God foreknew, He also predestined to be conformed to the likeness of His Son, that He might be the firstborn among many brothers. Also, those He predestined, He also called. Those He called, He also justified. Those he justified, he also glorified. What then shall we say in response to this? Say it with me. If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also, along with him, graciously give us all things? These are reasons for this attitude, the gratitude attitude. Who will bring any charge against those whom God has chosen? It is God who justifies. Who is he that condemns? Christ Jesus, who died, more than that, who was raised to life, is at the right hand of God and is also interceding for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall trouble or hardship or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? As it is written, for your sake we face death all day long. We are considered as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things, what does it say, my friend? We are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise God. And this tells us why we can have a gratitude attitude. This tells us why our souls can be filled with thankfulness and joy and peace and happiness, and how we can go home to the kingdom of God laughing and singing as we go. Amen. Listen to me. Such an attitude, which is largely missing in today's world, such an attitude is possible only to the soul that knows the reality of God and the meaningfulness of human existence. Listen to this tremendous statement, which is not original with me. This is the great choice, and this is the great divide between gratitude and despair, hope and hopelessness, life and death. The great choice that divides all of humanity and that divides the church. Am I a meaningless clot of coincidental molecules, as Richard Dawkins teaches? Or am I a child of God of infinite worth? Am I just a mass of molecules that arrived on the earth by chance? Or am I, like the Pilgrim Fathers taught, am I a child of God, made in the image of God, with a glorious destiny? You see, if a person believes that he's the product of blind chance and that nothing really counts, how can he have the gratitude attitude? Therefore, I say to you, we are children of a God of infinite worth. Therefore, be thankful, be grateful, have confidence, sing and rejoice. And today and every day, by the grace of God, let us have the gratitude attitude. I'm enjoying this today. Thank you. It's nice to get a little feedback, even if it's from some person who is going like this. Like the early American founders, who were not atheists, not atheistic evolutionists. They were not people who had taught themselves that there is no God and had killed every bright dream in their minds. The early Americans had the gratitude attitude like so many people in other countries around the world. But this country was founded not by atheists and not by communists. It was founded by people who had a resolute faith in God. And thus they set aside a whole day for the express purpose of showing gratitude and thankfulness to God. We are not unique in this. Canada has a day of gratitude in some other countries. But I think Americans just love this day because to them it's the best day in the year. The Puritans came over here in that tiny little boat, which was called what? The Mayflower. They came to this country seeking religious liberty. They came to this country because of the persecutions that they found in Great Britain and in the rest of Europe. They came here because they were Bible Christians. They believed in salvation by grace alone. They were Christians who believed in sola Christus, only Christ. Sola Scriptura, only Scripture. Only grace and only faith. And when they came here, it was not easy. They had a dreadful winter. And many of the early Americans died because of the severity of that winter. But in 1621, after a good harvest, they had a celebration at Plymouth in Massachusetts. They'd been helped by the Indians who provided seeds and taught them how to fish. And this was later made into something even bigger and better by that great man, Abraham Lincoln. In the midst of the bloody war, he proclaimed that there would be a day in which we would give thanks to God, and that every person would try to develop a spirit of thankfulness, or as we call it today, an attitude of thankfulness, an attitude of gratitude to Almighty God. Why should we be thankful? I would like to suggest there are many reasons. The text, Romans 8:28, says, with God, life has meaning. I believe this with all my soul, that life has meaning. I could not go on for another day if I did not believe in the infinite providence of God. I'm going to tell Pastor Venegas a story now. Some of you have heard this story, but I'm going to tell him the story. After we'd run a campaign in Russia, we came back via London. It's a huge city, one of the greatest cities in the world. And Beverly has always been a fan of Princess Di. She was a remarkable young woman, would have made a great queen, but we know her tragic end. But down at Kensington Palace, where she used to live on occasions, they were celebrating her life. And Beverly said, let's go down to Kensington Palace, because there were thousands of people bringing flowers. This was 10 years after her death. So we went down to Kensington Palace, and Javier and Susie Pirano came with us. And they went inside the museum, because inside the palace. But I had just been running a campaign, preaching every night. And after you've done this night after night after night, you've got to have some quiet. You can't just keep up the pressure. They said, come inside. I said, no, I don't want to go inside another palace or another museum. I've seen so many palaces and museums. I don't want to see another crown. And so I went around the back of the palace, and I sat down under a tree all by myself alone, in splendid isolation, until I heard my name called. Pastor John Carter. Oh, goodness. And a couple came to me. Not only did they come to me, but they came and embraced me and they kissed me. They said, we came to London to see you. I said, nobody knows I'm here. Ah, somebody knew. The Lord knew. They said, we have watched your television program. This is why we continue here. This is why we do this work. They said, we were atheists living in England. Our television set broke down, something broke down, and the only channel we could get was 3ABN. They said, we could not look at anything else but 3ABN. And we saw you week after week after week. And we gave our lives to Christ, and we were baptized, and we joined the church. Isn't this amazing? They said, we have relatives in Australia. And somehow, somebody had heard that you might be passing through England. On your way home to the United States, you might be passing through England. And so we prayed that God would help us to meet you. So we have been, they said, and they thought this was natural. They said, we have been much in prayer, and the Lord impressed us to come to London today. We don't live in London. We live 100 miles outside of London. And my family, we were all praying because we're all believers like you are. And therefore, we travel up on the train today, and we came to London, and we felt moved to go to Kensington Palace. Now, we felt impressed to go to Kensington Palace, not at 8 in the morning, not at 10 o'clock at night, not at 3 in the afternoon, but 11 o'clock this morning. And here you are. I say to the unbeliever, listen carefully, what chance is there of that happening? Well, you've got 65 million people in England alone. There are 365 days in the year. And there are 24 hours in the day. And there are literally hundreds of thousands of places, maybe millions of places, where you could meet in England, besides under a tree at the back of Kensington Palace. The chance of that happening, my friend, is not in 1,000,000,000,000. It is evidence that in all things, God works for the good of his people. Amen. This is evidence that there is a God in heaven. Praise God. Can you say hallelujah? That is why you and I ought to have a gratitude attitude, because God knows about us and he loves us and he has a plan for us. Amen. I just received a message from Pastor Harold Harker. There's a man, he is a knight of the British Order. He's Sir So-and-so in the Solomon Islands. I don't meet too many knights, but he came to our meetings, and he came to our meetings, listen to this, he came to the meetings carried as a cripple because he could not walk. And one night during the appeal for people to come down the front, as 10,000 out of 35,000 people would come down the front. He raised his hand, unable to walk. And I read the story of the woman who reached out the finger, the trembling finger of faith. And Christ said, your faith has healed you. Go in peace. And he said, well, if it happened to that woman, it can happen to me. I won't tell you his name, but Sir So-and-so said, I will put my faith in Christ. And he rose up and he walked, and he's been walking ever since. Now, we would tell you, we are not faith healers. I am not a faith healer, but I believe in a God who can heal, you see. And they've got more faith out in those places than they have here in the churches in North America. Because all things work together for good, because God has a plan and a purpose for every life, for your life and my life, we need to have in our souls the gratitude attitude. Can you say amen? Yes. We can be thankful Because God supplies our needs. Come over here to Matthew chapter 6, 25 and onwards. God supplies our needs, sometimes in spite of us. Matthew chapter 6, 25 to 30, the words of our blessed Lord. Matthew 6, 25 and onwards. Therefore, I tell you, Jesus said, do not worry about your life, what you will eat or drink, or about your body, what you will wear. Is not life more important than food, and the body more important than clothes? Look at the birds of the air. Just stop for a moment. Last night, I called out to Beverly about 10 o'clock at night. I said, listen to that amazing bird singing outside the window. She said, it's on the computer. Okay. I'm telling you, folks, it's hard to have an attitude of gratitude all the time, but okay. Look at the birds of the air. They do not sow or reap or store away in barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not much more valuable than they? Who of you by worrying can add a single hour to his life? And then, why do you worry about clothes? See how the lilies of the field grow. They do not labor or spin. Yet I tell you that not even Solomon in all his splendor was dressed like one of these. If that is how God clothes the grass of the field, which is here today and tomorrow is thrown into the fire, will he not much more clothe you, O you of little faith? Because of the certainty of the fact that God supplies our needs, we need to have the gratitude attitude. He gives us food. He gives us clothing. He gives us a roof over our heads. He gives us family and friends. And he gives us the church of the living God. Now, a person who's got a testimony, she told me about it, and it touched my heart, I'd never heard it before, is Susan Pirino. I'm going to ask her to come. She told me this story happened some time ago, but it just sort of touched me and amazed me. Good morning, Susan.
Good morning, Pastor Carter.
How are you this morning?
I'm doing fine, thank you.
Have you a gratitude attitude?
I definitely do.
Now tell me why.
Well, as most people here in the church know, we came to know the gospel through your ministry in the Shrine Auditorium. Mm-hmm. Javier and I attended every night, and I was out of the church, and Javier was not a Christian. So after the meetings, we were baptized into your church, mm-hmm. and we started attending. And of course, like most couples, we were very much in debt. And I wasn't working, so Javier was the only working person. And we learned about tithing. We hadn't been doing that. And so we thought, we need to do this. But I was doing it backwards. I was paying the bills, and then at the end, seeing if I had anything left over for the tithing. And we didn't seem to go anywhere. Our finances were very, very limited. And finally, I thought, I kept reading and studying. I heard a sermon that you preached on giving to the Lord and putting God first. And I thought, you know what? We're doing this backwards. I need to pay the tithe first and then pay the bills. So I started to do that. And it came up where one day I was paying the bills. I did the tithe check first, but I didn't have enough for our car insurance, which I'll never forget was $221. But I thought, I'll let Javier know he can work extra hours, and when he makes the money, then I'll pay it, and we'll pay the fine. So I did that, and I didn't send the bill, the payment. So I went to the post office box the next day, and I got the mail, and I looked through it, and I was about to throw it away, and I thought, wait, this looks like a check. So I opened it up, and sure enough, it was a letter from our insurance company. Back when the boys were born, which had been 3 or 4 years before that, we had overpaid some money, and there was a check for $222. Mm. It was a dollar more than my insurance need.
Hallelujah. Read us a text.
So this text really comes to heart. It says, bring the whole tithe into the storehouse, that there may be food in my house. Test me in this, says the Lord Almighty, and see if I will not throw open the floodgates of heaven and pour out so much blessing that you will not have room enough for it. And I am a testament to this text because God proved to me that He did open the gates. And ever since then, our income has never been, you know, huge, but all our bills have been paid. We got out of debt. We put our kids in the academy, which we didn't know we could do. And God continues to bless us and provide all our needs.
Thank God. Thank God, Susan. Wonderful testimony. Why we can have an attitude of gratitude. Now, a very special person in this church is Mr. Jose Salgati. He's a very dear friend of mine. I'm going to ask him now to come. I don't know a harder working person. I don't know a better family. And I don't know a better builder. He builds the best houses. You've got always the gratitude attitude. Tell me some things why you are grateful, my brother.
Pastor Carter, there are many things for what reason I need to say glory be to God, because He blessed me every day, every day. But you know something, two and a half years ago, I had been the worst, very hard time in my life.
The recession?
The recession time. For 14 months, I couldn't do work any day. You know very well that situation because you were very close to me, praying for me. Many people in the church were praying for me also, you know. But I remember exactly, Pastor Carter, was very hard time, but I never, never I forgot God's promises. You know what? Because I knew God, He loved me, I say to myself, because He sent His Son to go to the cross and die for me for one reason, because He's loved me. He never left me alone. No. For that reason, Pastor Karen, I am very happy. Thank you, God, for every sin. Every sin is good for me. It doesn't matter what is the problem. I know the solution is coming soon. And from the hard time, I learned a lot of things. God love. Pastor Karen, thank you for this opportunity to give my real testimony.
God bless you, my brother.
God bless you, too.
Just a special man with a special relationship with God. You know, folks, it's easy to have faith in God when everything's easy, isn't it? But when things are falling apart and the recession has knocked out your business, but I want you to know we can have this gratitude attitude because God always comes through. We can be grateful because of Christ and the gospel. I want you to come over now to John chapter 3 and verse 16. Now, you shouldn't have to turn to that text, but we're going to turn to it just because we're going to turn to it. Come over here to John chapter 3 and verse 16. John chapter 3, verse 16. This is the greatest text in all the Bible. John chapter 3, verse 16. You can say it with me together. For God so loved the world that He gave His one and only Son, that whoever believes in Him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. My friend, you and I can be glad, as Mr. Salgati said, that we've got a Father who sent His Son. God knows about us. Do you ever have a down days? You wonder what's going to happen? Now, for the folks watching the telecast in other parts of the world, and we have a great audience around the world, but here in America, it's been tough. But God has supplied our needs. And as Jose told you, He supplied our needs because we've got a Father, and He sent His Son, and His Son died for us. And if His Son died for us, He's going to see us through. Now, I want you to come over now to another text that talks about the gospel. I want you to come over here to Luke chapter 15, verses 1 and 2. Luke chapter 15 and verses 1 and 2. You got it? Luke chapter 15, verse 1 and 2. Now the tax collectors and sinners were all gathering around to hear Him, but the Pharisees and the teachers of the law muttered, "This man welcomes sinners and eats with them." And Jesus said to the Pharisees, "You're wrong on everything, but on this you're right." this man does receive sinners. That's the gospel. And then Jesus told three stories to illustrate the glory of the gospel. And verses 3 and 4, then Jesus told them this parable. Suppose one of you has 100 sheep and loses one of them. Does he not leave the 99 in the open country and go after the lost sheep until he finds it? And when he finds it, he joyfully puts it on his shoulders. This tells me that God loves us and that Jesus is the good shepherd and he's searching for us. This tells us why we can be thankful. I want you to come down a little bit further. Come down to verse 8. Or suppose a woman has 10 silver coins and loses one. Does she not light a lamp, sweep the house, and search carefully until she finds it? And when she finds it, she calls her friends and neighbors together and says, "Rejoice with me. I have found my lost coin." In the same way, I tell you, there is rejoicing in the presence of the angels of God over one sinner who repents. This tells me he loves me. He cares for me. He's searching for me. And then Jesus tells the story of the lost boy. I want you to notice this. Verse 11, Jesus continued, "There was a man who had two sons. The younger one said to his father, 'Father, give me my share of the estate.' So he divided his property between them." You know the story. We call him the prodigal son. He's the waster. He goes out and he spends his father's wealth. He spends it on harlots and alcohol and tobacco, cocaine and everything. And then he's right down at the bottom of the pit, but he comes to himself. You know the story. And when he goes home, he's moved by the Spirit of God to go home. And the old father is standing there at the gate, and he's looking down the road, looking for the boy. And the boy, covered with the filth of the pig pen, wonders, "Is my father going to kick me out?" But when his father sees the boy coming, the Bible tells me the father runs down the road, grabs the boy, and he hugs him. He doesn't kick him, he kisses him. And then they have a tremendous party and they kill the fattened calf. And the father says, "Rejoice, because my son was dead." I want you to know I was that boy. You know what we're talking about? But we have a father and the father loves us. And I want you to know today that we can have an attitude of gratitude, the gratitude attitude, because of the Father, because of forgiveness. We can thank God for the welcome home. We can thank God for the restoration. We can thank God for the robe and the party. We can thank God for the gospel, which is the good news of God. Now, I've got some folks here today in this church, and I love them so much. And I'm going to ask them to come up the front and tell me why they've got a gratitude attitude and why they can give thanks to God. I'm going to ask Alan DeLeon to come up. Alan, welcome Alan to church, folks. We're glad to have Alan in church today. Alan, tell me. What are you thankful about?
I'm thankful for the fact that God has guided me throughout my life in all decisions, big and small. He's always constant, and I can always count on him for anything, no matter what it is.
I know that in recent months that God has been doing a special work for you. Do you feel the love of the Savior?
Always, and I'm always reminded of it, and it's always constant. Every day I wake up and I just see all of the ways that he blesses me, and he continues to bless me, and it's hard to ignore, and which is why I'm so thankful for him, because he does everything for me.
And we're thankful to God for you. God bless you, Alan. We're glad you're a member of our church. Another special member of our church is Sydney Wexler. got wonderful parents, a great little brother by the name of Benjamin. Not doing too bad, this memory. Okay. Hello, Sydney.
Hello, Pastor Carter. Happy Sabbath.
Oh, happy Sabbath. You look really cute today. Tell me, have you got a gratitude attitude, and why are you so thankful?
Yes, very much so, Pastor Carter. There are so many ways that God has blessed me in my life. The first thing that comes to my mind is my school, because I go to a Christian school that offers such a unique classical education. Ooh. I'm also thankful for my friends who are always by my side and always willing to help and support me. I'm also thankful that God has given me my family, my friends, this wonderful church, and the salvation that I have through faith in Jesus Christ.
Oh, that's great. Would you like a kiss? Are you not too much into kisses? Well, I'm going to give you just a, you ready for it? Okay. You waiting for it? Okay. She doesn't usually like too many kisses, but you ready for it? Now, here it comes. Thank you, Sydney. Thank you, sweetie. It's really, really good. Another great family is the Molina family with Mei Ling. Just great folks. Leilani. What a pretty name. Come up, Leilani. Leilani Molina. Come over here, sweetie pie. How are you?
I'm good, thank you, Pastor Carter.
Are you thankful today?
Yes, I am. There's many reasons that I'm thankful to the Lord for, but one of the main reasons is for my family and friends, because they're always there for me, and they can always deal with me in anything that I need. And I'm also thankful for my good health and a good school that I go to. Mm. I'm thankful to have a home where I can always feel secure and at home. And just to have a roof over my head and food on the table every day is a huge blessing. But above everything else, I'm grateful to have the Lord as my Savior, and just to know that He's always there for me no matter what is the greatest blessing I can ask for.
You're a blessing to us. Now, get ready for it. You're ready for which side do you want it on? This side, because it's easiest for me. Then I don't have to go around the other side. Are you ready? Okay. You ready now? God bless you, Leilani. God bless you, sweetie. Yeah, what beautiful, beautiful young people. Fine young man in our church is David Mercado. Mm-hmm. David, we're proud of you. Just proud of you. Mm-hmm. David, welcome to church. Tell me, are you thankful?
Yes, for the peace I have in my Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Having the assurance that no matter what I go through, He'll never fail me. And I can truly say in everything that I've gone through, whether bad or good, He's always been by my side.
That's a great testimony, David. We're proud of you and we thank you.
Thank you.
We're glad you're a member of this church. We're going to part a little bit now from the young people of the church, but I want you to welcome a special guest, Pastor James Venegas. Now, Pastor Venegas, we're glad that you're with us from the land down under. Tell us, have you got the gratitude attitude? What are you grateful for?
Absolutely, Pastor Carter. My gratitude attitude is because God has called me to serve Him amongst people, but also that He sustained me through the toughest times in my life. In particular, having lost my father a few years ago, very dark time, just when I started to study theology at college. Mm. It did threaten to derail me. There were times where things were so tough that I would just cry myself to sleep. My wife knows this. I lost confidence that God would bring me back on track. And yet through it all, God was always there. And from the deepest part of my soul, I'm just so thankful that He has sustained me. And now I can help other people going through similar things that I went through.
We're thankful to God for you, and we want to thank you for traveling all that distance, that 8,000 miles, and coming to visit us at our church. And we hope we're going to see much more of you. God bless you, my brother. Thank you. Thank you. Now we have Matthew Cruz. Now he comes from just a great family. He's got his grandmother there, Joni, and she's rooting for him today. Good morning, Matthew.
Good morning.
How are you doing this morning?
Good.
Now, what are you thankful for?
Well, Pastor Carter, what I'm thankful for is my loving church family. The reason why is because they encouraged me to come to church and encouraged me to read my Bible.
Well, I'm just thankful to have such a fine young man in our church. I really am. And you've got just the most beautiful little sister, whose name is Helene. And she's here today with your mom and your grandparents. So we're proud to have you as a member of our church. God bless you, Matthew. Now, we want the congregation to take their Bibles and turn to Psalm 107, verses 1 to 15. Psalm 107, verses 1 to 15. Now, we're going to do something different. Psalm 107, we're going to do what the early Christians used to do in this great land. When they read the scripture, you know what they did? They stood up when they read. So we're going to have to do a little bit of work with these cameras. We want you all to stand up now. Stand up. We're going to read together every verse, Psalm 107, down to verse 15. You folks ready to go? Mm-hmm. Did you enjoy this table? Mrs. Eunice Fletcher prepared this. This is the Thanksgiving table. Isn't that a beautiful symbol of the gospel of our blessed Lord? Here we go. All together, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever. Let the redeemed of the Lord say this, those he redeemed from the hand of the foe, those he gathered from the lands, from east and west, from north and south. Some wandered in desert wastelands, finding no way to a city where they could settle. They were hungry and thirsty, and their lives ebbed away. Then they cried out to the Lord in their trouble, and he delivered them from their distress. He led them by a straight way to a city where they could settle. Let them give thanks to the Lord for his unfailing love and his wonderful deeds for men. For he satisfies the thirsty and fills the hungry with good things. Some sat in darkness and the deepest gloom, prisoners suffering in iron chains, for they had rebelled against the words of God and despised the counsel of the Most High. So he subjected them to bitter labor. They stumbled, and there was no one to help. Then they cried to the Lord in their trouble, and he saved them from their distress. He brought them out of darkness and the deepest gloom and broke away their chains together now. Let them give thanks to the Lord for his unfailing love and his wonderful deeds for men. May the Lord bless us as together we give thanks to the Lord. Let us kneel now as we pray. Have you been blessed today? Mm. Have you all got this gratitude attitude now? Okay, that gratitude attitude has got to last longer than the close of the sermon. So when you go out the doors today, and when Murta plays the great pipe organ and you disperse, take with you an attitude of gratitude. And let us give thanks. Let us pray. Our Father, we thank you today for the greatness of who you are. We thank you that you are a God of infinite capacity and love and mercy. We thank you that this man receives sinners and goes to eat with them. We thank you that you came down looking for the lost sheep and the lost coin and the lost boy. We thank you that God so loved the world that he gave his only son. We thank you, our Father, for helping Javier and Susie when they couldn't pay the insurance on the car. And the check came because you fulfilled the promise of Malachi chapter 3, which is given to all those who pay their tithes to God. We thank you for our brother Jose. During a time of darkness and almost despair, you kept him and his family, and now the sun is starting to shine again and the work has opened up. We thank you for the young people and the children who in their hearts have got an attitude of thankfulness to God for parents and loved ones, for Jesus most of all, for good schools, and for this blessed church. Our Father, on our knees today, we thank you. How many today will raise a hand and a heart and say, I thank you, Lord. Can you raise your hand and say today, I thank you, Lord. I thank you that today I have this gratitude, attitude, because of all the good things. We raise a hand and a heart, hands and hearts to you. We praise you today. We thank you. We bless you. We give you glory. In Jesus' precious name. Amen.
Like most of us, I am thankful for many things. Family, friends, work that I love. But today I'd like to talk to you about God's precious promises and for some specific ones. Nearly 20 years ago, I developed a very debilitating health problem for which the doctors have never been able to find a cause or a cure. And over these years, I've studied prayer and promises from the Bible, such as Mark 11:24, which says, therefore I tell you, whatever you ask for in prayer, believe that you have received it and it will be yours. Now, I have prayed, I have believed, but this promise still hasn't been fulfilled in my life. Now, I know many of you here and also watching this telecast have had unanswered prayers. Many of us have prayed for loved ones to be healed only to see them pass away. I've learned many lessons during these years, and I'd like to share just a couple with you this morning. Firstly, for the Christian, God's no is only seemingly so. Rather, it is God's delay. Some years ago, I came upon a wonderful quote, which I wrote in my Bible, and it says, delays in God's promises do not weaken the strength of the divine promise. When God's promise to physically heal seems to be no, it is but a delay. Sometimes it's a short delay in this life. Other times it's delayed until the second coming. Ultimately, every promise to God's children of restoration will be fulfilled at Christ's return. The second lesson I've learned is to be thankful for the spiritual promises that God has fulfilled in my life during these difficult years. Jeremiah 29:12, I will listen to you. And of course, this is God speaking. Isaiah 66:13, I will comfort you. Isaiah 41:10, I will strengthen you. And John 14:27, I will give you peace. Now, these promises are for the benefit of our spiritual health, our spiritual lives. And as long as we trust God, He will always readily fulfill them. He has done it for me and for millions of others. And so today, let's thank our Heavenly Father for His glorious promises. They will never fail while our lives are in His hands. Amen. Happy Thanksgiving.